Thank you so kindly for tuning in this morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. We're excited and delighted that you have tuned in to our Sunday morning worship service here at Bible Way Community Baptist Church. Before we get started this morning, I just wanted to kind of give you a preview and kind of let you know what we're going to be talking about for the next few weeks. I'm going to be preaching a series of messages on voting your Christian value. Yes, voting your Christian value. Yes, it's that time a year again for us to go and register to vote and sign up to vote and get on out there and vote. And I hope that you have signed up. I hope that you have registered to go out and vote. You know, we live here in America and we have a republic form of government. And so the way that we are to show our pledge for our politician is we vote them in and we keep them in office. But if we don't like them, we don't have to riot, we don't have to start a revolution. We just go down there and vote them out. We just go vote them out. And so we want to talk to you for the next few weeks about voting your Christian value. Yes, everybody else is talking about voting. The man out on the street is talking about voting. Every night you have one of these newscasters that's talking about voting, politicians that's talking about voting. It would be irresponsible of me as your pastor, as your shepherd, if I did not say something to you about voting and voting your Christian value. People are saying, wait a minute, Pastor, I mean, shouldn't that be separation of church and state? Yeah, but it's not separation of state and God. No, God is the one that gave the state its rights. And so all of our rights, all our privileges is come from the Lord. And so I, as your pastor, I need to be like the great shepherd. I need to try to lead you beside some still waters. Yeah, and some greener grass and some greener pastures. And so tune in for the next few weeks and listen to what the Lord is dealing with, how the Lord is dealing with me and leading me as I lead you. Now, pray for me. You're going to pray. You need to pray for me as I lead you where God would have all of us to go. Now, let me go and change clothes, and I'll see you in church. All right.
Good morning. Let me invite you to open up your Bibles to the book of Psalms, Psalms 11. And I want to look at that Psalms this morning, but I want to look particularly at verse number 3. Psalms 11, verse 3. David says, "If the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do?" That's what I want to talk about this morning. If the foundations be destroyed. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you for who you are, the God who hears and you still answer prayers. Lord, give me preaching grace. Give your people hearing grace. Then give us all doing grace. And we'll be careful to praise you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If the foundations be destroyed. When I looked at this verse and I began to observe it and study this scripture, a couple of things jumped out at me. The first thing that jumped out at me, David says, if the foundations, he didn't say if the foundation. No, he says, if the foundations be destroyed. In other words, he's talking about more than one foundation. And David, because he was a king, David knew that every country, every nation is built on at least three foundations. It's built, first of all, on a political foundation. It's got to have some kind of political structure. And then it's built upon an economic foundation. It's got to have some kind of financial structure. And then it's built upon a religious foundation, whether they believe in God of the Bible, or whether they believe in some other God, or whether they believe in no God at all. It has a religious foundation. When I look at our country and how our founding fathers set up America, they laid some good foundations. Oh, yes, I believe they laid a good political foundation because our government is a republic form of government where we elect our leaders to represent us. And we have three forms of branches of government. We have a judicial branch. We have an executive branch. And we have a legislative branch, just like it was set up in the Bible over in the book of Ezra. And then we have a good economic foundation. Here in America, we believe in capitalism. Capitalism believes in the rights for private property, private ownership. So you can go and work hard, and then you can buy your own land, and then you can build your own house on your own land, and then you can raise your own crops on your own land, and you can raise your own animals on your own land. And really can't nobody tell you what to do with your property, because that's your property. It's private property, just like it was, and that's based upon the Bible, because God's whole concept of the promised land was to give every man there in Israel a piece of land where he can have his own house, and he can raise his own food, he could have his own vineyard, and have his own fig trees. And so it's based upon the Bible. We have a good economic foundation. And then we have a good religious foundation. Our founding fathers, they believed in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They believed in the God of the Bible. They believed in the Ten Commandments. They believe in keeping those first two commandments that talks about having no other God before me. And then they believe in keeping that a fourth commandment about the Sabbath day, and they took Sunday as their Sabbath day, and they believed that we should have Sunday of worship, and they believed in honoring your father and your mother, and thou shalt not steal, and thou shalt not kill. And so, in other words, they laid for us a good religious foundation. But when I look at this verse, there's some mess that jumped out at me. David says, if the foundations be destroyed. That first word, that two-letter word, David says, if the foundation. And notice now, David didn't say if the windows be destroyed. That's an easy fix. You can easily fix some windows. David didn't say if the doors be destroyed. You can easily fix some doors. You can always go get you some more doors. David didn't say now if the a roof is being destroyed, that's a little bit harder, but you can fix a roof. But David says, if the foundation be the foundation is what everything else is built upon. That's the most important part of a building. A building is only as good as its foundation. But David says, if the foundation be destroyed. Well, why did David say, if the foundation? Because David knew that in the life of every nation, there will come a day, there will come a time when that nation will go through a revolution, and they will tear up even the foundation. See, it's just like a house. It's just like a house. A man can get married, and him and his wife, they go and find them some land, and then they begin to build their house. They lay the foundation, they put up the walls, and they put up the ceiling, they put up the roof, and they build them a house. And after 30, 40, 50 years, then they pass that house on to their children, and then their children, they keep the house for another 10, 15, 20 years, and then they pass the house on to their children, and it goes on and on and on. But there will come a day, there will come a time, there will be a generation who didn't know their grandparents or their great-grandparents or their great-great-grandparents, whoever laid the foundation of that house. There will come a generation that really don't respect them because they really didn't know them. And as a result, they will let the house go down, or they will tear down the house altogether. In other words, they will destroy the very foundation that their foreparents built. That's how it is in a family. That's how it is in a nation. When the nation was first founded, those people who knew the founders, they tried to preserve the foundation. They tried to preserve the religious foundation and the economic foundation and the political foundation. But as time has went on, and now we're over 250 years past the founding fathers, they are growing up now a generation who has no respect at all for the founding fathers. As a result, they say, we need to just get rid of these foundations. We need to get rid of the political foundation. We need to get rid of the economic foundation. We need to get rid of the religious foundation. They say we just need to get rid of these foundations, and we need to start over from scratch. See, you and I, if you over 50 years old, you was taught to respect and have a great love for God, and have a great love for others, and have a great love for your family and your country. But today we are not being taught to have a great love for God and others and family and country. Today a lot of the kids, they are being taught a revisionary kind of history. They are not teaching it just like it is. They are changing things for their own good and for their own purpose. In other words, they got an agenda, ladies and gentlemen. So they are not getting the same history lessons that we was once taught. See, when you went to school, and you was taught to pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic of which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible with liberty and justice for all. You was taught to sing, "My country, tears of thee, sweet land of liberty of thee I sing, land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim pride, from every mountainside let freedom ring." You was taught those kind of songs, those patriotic kind of songs, but today they're not being taught those kinds of things. And as a result, these kids, they are being taught that revisionary history, and they are being taught that all of our founding fathers, they was slave owners, and they was all rich, and they was all powerful, and they was abusive to their slaves, and they was abusive to others. And as a result, they built a flawful kind of constitution. And so we just need to tear it up and just start all over. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you ought not be believing stuff like that, because not every white man in slavery owned slaves. No. And not every white man back then was evil. It's just like today. It's not every white man, it's got black folks working for them. No, you got, it's just, matter of fact, you got more poor white people than you have poor black people. It's more poor white people on welfare than it is poor black people on welfare. So we got to get the record straight. Oh, see what's happening today. These folks are trying to start a revolution, because they are wanting to tie up the economic foundation. When you look at your evening news, that's what is happening. When you see them burning up private property and burning up buildings that somebody worked hard to establish that business, and burning up cars and stuff, what they are doing, they are trying to destroy the economic foundation. And then when you see them pulling down statues, they started with the Confederate statues and things like that, but they are now moving on and tearing down statues of George Washington and Abraham Lincoln, even tearing down the statues of people like Frederick Douglass. What they are trying to do, they are trying to tie up their political foundation. And then they are moving on to trying to destroy their religious foundation. Matter of fact, for the last 50, 60 years, they've been trying here in America to destroy the religious foundation. When you go back to the early 1960s, you see them, they took prayer out of school. And then in the 1970s, they began to legalize abortion. Then in the 1980s, they began to pull down those Ten Commandments and say you can't have the Ten Commandments in the schoolyards, in the schoolhouse, because the kids, if they see them, they just might obey them. And so they say we got to pull them things down. And then in the 1990s and the 2000s, we began to see the gay pride parade. The gays began to go in the closet, and Christians come out of the closet, and Christians began to go in the closet. And then in 2015, we saw them legalize gay marriages. And today we see that the churches are closed while the liquor stores are open. They are looking at churches as being non-essential business, but liquor stores are essential business. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, we are going through here a revolution right here in America. They are tearing up our foundation. They are tearing up the political foundation. They are tearing up the economic foundation. They are tearing up the religious foundation. Well, what do you do when you see the foundations are being destroyed? Thank you for asking, David. David says, if the foundation be destroyed, what can the righteous do? Is there anything that the righteous can do? Oh, yes. Oh, yes. There's a lot that the righteous can do. I want to give you three things I believe that the righteous can do to turn this thing around. The first thing that the righteous need to do is keep watching. Keep watching. You know, Jesus, before he went to the cross, he went to the Garden of Gethsemane, and he took with him Peter, James, and John, and he told them, watch with me. What was Jesus saying? Well, that word watch is used a number of ways in Scripture. In that particular sense, Jesus was saying, stand guard while I go over there and pray. But you know the story. After Jesus had prayed, he came back. He saw him sleeping. They had fell asleep. And Jesus said, you couldn't stay woke for just 1 hour. You couldn't watch with me? No. They had went to sleep. Do you know, when I was a little boy, my middle brother, he told me the story about Rip Van Winkle. You know Rip Van Winkle. It was a story that was written by Washington Irving. And the thing about that story, Rip Van Winkle was a man that had slept for 20 years. But the irony of that story is that when Rip Van Winkle first laid down to go to sleep, there was a picture of King George III, the King of England. But when he woke up 20 years later, there was a picture of George Washington, the first president of the United States. And when Rip looked at the picture, he didn't know who George Washington was. Why he didn't know who he was? He had slept through a revolution. That's what's happening today, church. The reason we're seeing these people are able to come and just tie up the political foundation and the economic foundation and the religious foundation is because the church is sleeping through a revolution. Change is taking place and the church is sleeping. It's time that the church wake up and watch. Get on guard. Just like Jesus told the church there over in Sardis in the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 3, he said, wake up and strengthen the things that remain. That's what we got to do. We got to wake up and get on guard, ladies and gentlemen, and start guarding those things that remain so that the enemy won't go on and take up everything that we got. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, we got to wake up because a revolution is being taken place. You know, when George Floyd died, those people in Minneapolis, the rioters came out and they began to start destroying. Looked like the whole town of Minneapolis. But then the governor got smart and he went on and called the National Guard out. And when the National Guard came, they set up a guard and they began to stand in front of those buildings and stuff. And they made sure that they protected those buildings. They made sure that nobody else could burn those buildings. You know why? Because they had set up a guard. And that's what we got to do, ladies and gentlemen. We got to set up a guard to make sure that these folks don't come along and keep on tearing up the political foundation or tearing up the economic foundation or tearing up the religious foundation. We got to set up a guard. And who do we need to be on guard against? We need to be on guard against people like the Black Lives Matter group. Oh, yes, we need to be on guard. Because, see, even though they got a good name, they don't really have good intentions, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, they're not really concerned about all these black lives that are dying. If they was, they would be up there in Chicago trying to do something about that, or major cities trying to do about this black on black crime. But they have an agenda. See, really, that's a homosexual organization that really has a homosexual agenda to destroy the traditional family. Yeah, the family between the husband and wife, man and woman. See, they want to see family not with Adam and Eve, but they want to see Adam and Steve. They want to see those kind of family, but really they want to see Eve and Yvette. That's the kind of family that they want to see. But ladies and gentlemen, we better be guarding the traditional family, because they want to destroy the traditional family. But that organization is not only a homosexual organization, but it's also a Marxist organization. In other words, they believe in communism, and that's really why they want to defund the police. They're not so much concerned about the black lives, the white cops killing. What they are trying to do, they are trying to overthrow the government. And if they can defund the police, in other words, if we can take the law officer and put him in his place, and then we can bring our own people then. That's communism, ladies and gentlemen. And so we need to be on the guard. See, I know that you're thinking, well, see, them black folks, see, the devil can use anybody. He'll use black folks against black folks. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, you know, Jesus said it like this. It's like wolves in sheep's clothing. And that's what we got here. They may be black on the outside, but they're wolves in sheep's clothing. So we better set up a guard. But there's another way this word watch is used. This word watch is also used to mean to observe, to pay attention to. What do we need to be watching? What do we need to be paying attention to? We don't need to just only have a guard and have our guard up, yes, but we need to be watching ourselves as well as watching God. We need to watch ourselves to make sure that we are in line with the Bible. See, because, see, God is watching us. Look here back at the text over in Psalm 11, beginning with verse 4. It said, the Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes, behold, his eyelids try the children of men. The Lord tries the righteous, but the wicked and him that loveth violence, his soul hate. Upon the wicked he shall rain snares, fire, and brimstone, and horrible temper. This shall be the portion of their cup. Ladies and gentlemen, we better be watching ourselves and making sure that we are righteous and lining up with the scriptures, because God is watching us. God is watching the good, the bad, and the ugly. You know, they used to sing that song at Christmas time, Santa Claus is coming to town. He knows that you've been sleeping. He knows when you are awake. He knows when you've been bad or good. So be good for goodness sake, because Santa Claus is coming to town. We don't really have to worry about Santa Claus, but we need to be worried about God Almighty, because Jesus is coming back again, and you don't want him to catch you with your work undone. And see, he's testing you. He's testing you to see how you gonna respond to this revolution. He's testing you to see, are you gonna step out of line and start following the crowd, or are you gonna stay in line with the scriptures? He is looking and he's testing you to see if you're gonna follow your color. All the black folks is going over there. Are you going to stay with your Christ? He want to see, are you going to go to the right politically, or go to the left politically? Are you going to stay with the Bible? What are you going to do? God is testing us today. And God want to see who's going to stay on the Lord's side. You know, Abraham Lincoln, one day, one of the soldiers came to him. And one of the soldiers, during the Civil War, say, President Lincoln, Do you believe that God is on our side? President Lincoln dropped his head and looked at the young man. He said, a more important question, son, is are we on his side? That's the thing, ladies and gentlemen. It's not so much as God on our side, but are we on God's side? The scriptures talk about God is watching us, ladies and gentlemen. And so that's what we can do. We can keep watching. But number two, we can keep praying. Yeah, when you see these foundations being destroyed, when you see these people destroying the political foundation, when you see them destroying their religious foundation and their economic foundation, you don't have to just sit on the sideline and cry. No, you can talk to your Heavenly Father. He sits high, but he looks low, and he can fix things down here. You know, in Elijah's day, I thank God for the Bible, because the Bible often shows us worst case scenario. And when you look at the Bible, in Elijah's day, there was a king that came to the throne, was one of the most wickedest king that ever lived, the king Ahab. But he had a wicked wife by the name of Jezebel, and they were some kind of wicked dynamic duo. Matter of fact, they had came to the throne and they began to just tear up everything that had been laid by previous generation. They began to tear up the political foundation. They began to tear up the economic foundation. They began to tear up the religious foundation. And they had in the religious foundation, they started a new religion by instituting Baal worship. So some of the people, what they was doing, they was straddling the fence. They was worshiping Baal sometime, and then they would worship God sometime. Sometime they would come over here and worship Baal. They were straddling the fence. So when Elijah saw them straddling the fence, Elijah called them out on it. Elijah, the man of God, the prophet of God, he showed up and says, how long will you be between two opinions? Is Baal, is God, go on and serve him. But if God is God, serve him. And he said, we need to just solve this issue once and for all. Why don't we just have a God contest? Why don't we go ahead and put a sacrifice out there and lay the sacrifice on the altar? And the God that answers by fire, then that's the God that we ought to serve. And so that's what the false prophet did. Ahab had 400 false prophets. Jezebel had 450 false prophets, 850 false prophets. They came together and they began to put their sacrifice on the altar. And then early that morning, they started at sunrise. They started calling on Baal, 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 send the fire. 7 o'clock, Baal, Baal, send the fire. 8 o'clock, Baal, Baal, send the fire. 9 o'clock, Baal, Baal, send the fire. 10 o'clock, Baal, Baal, send the fire. 11 o'clock, Baal, Baal, send the fire. 12 o'clock noon, the fire still hadn't came. Bam! They began to start cutting theyself. They start jumping up and down, screaming and hollering, trying to get Baal attention. But Baal wouldn't send the fire. Elijah said, okay, y'all done had y'all chance time up. And Elijah went and he rebuilt the broken down altar. That altar that where they used to bring sacrifices to the Lord. He had to go over there and rebuild it. And he rebuilt that broken down altar. Then he put that sacrifice on the altar. Then he went and dumped some water all on the sacrifice. Then he put some water all around the sacrifice. And then he got down on his knees. And he says, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, send down the fire. And immediately, God sent down the fire. And the fire burned up the sacrifice. And the fire began to lick up all the water around the sacrifice. And the people knew that day that God was God, because God hear, and not only do he hear, but he answers prayers. And as a result, the people began to leave Baal, and they came on back to God. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, in other words, a revival started. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe the same thing can happen today, even though we see a revolution taking place. I believe we can see a revival take place if God's people would get on their knees and pray. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, the Bible says, call unto me and I'll answer thee and show you great and mighty things that you know not. Of the Bible says, the prayers of a righteous man availeth much. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, what can we do? What can the righteous do when they see all of these folks tearing up the foundation, when the foundation are being destroyed? What can you do? You can keep watching. Number two, you can keep praying. But number three, you can keep on fighting. Oh, yeah, you can keep on fighting. You know, the Bible says over there in Ephesians chapter 6, beginning with verse number 10, it says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you might be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this world, against wicked spirit in high places. And then he tells us to go on and put that whole armor on. But then when you come to verse 17, it says, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. See, ladies and gentlemen, we are to win the battle not with sticks and stones, but we are to win this battle with the word of God. Oh, that's what people need today. People today, they need the word of God. We are in a fight, but we are not in a flesh and blood fight. We are in a spiritual fight. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, I can recall what Dr. Martin Luther King said back in his day, when he went to Memphis, right before the last time he went to Memphis, he went there to have a protest, to lead a protest, to help those garbage workers. But that protest ended up becoming a riot because the FBI, they had planted some rioters in their protests, among the protesters, in order to make Dr. King look bad. So when Dr. King had to hurry up and get on out of town because it was a bad ride, and he went on back to Atlanta. But see, the thing was, a lot of his men's they had deserted him. Jesse Jackson and some of the others, they had deserted him doing their own thing. And so he had called them in and he says, listen, y'all don't understand what this fight is all about. This fight is not really a flesh and blood fight. This fight, we are not fighting so you can just get a new house and a bigger house and live out in the suburbs and be able to drive big fancy cars. He says, no, we are not fighting for all of these material things, even though those things are important. He said, we are fighting for the soul of this country. He says, America is sick, and we're fighting for the soul of America. Now, that was over 50-something years ago, ladies and gentlemen. If America was sick in Dr. King day, then America is dying today. Matter of fact, America is on life support, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, we are living in a sick country. We are seeing people tearing up the very foundation of this country because they are sick. And we're not going to be able to turn their minds around by getting in their faces and cursing them out and calling them all kinds of names. We got to give these people Jesus Christ, because these people, they need Jesus. You know, Erica Campbell sang that song saying, I need a little more Jesus. Yeah, but these folks that's out there in the street that's tearing up stuff, they ain't got no Jesus at all. So they need a lot of Jesus. And we're not going to be able to win this battle by hating on the abortionists. We can't get in the abortionist's face and hate on that abortionist. We can't get in the homosexual face and hate on the homosexual. We can't get in the evolutionary person face and hate on the people because they believe in evolution. We can't hate on these other folks that believe in other religions and other gods. We gotta come and do what the Bible says. We gotta fight this Bible, fight this country the Bible way, ladies and gentlemen. The Bible says, love your enemies. The Bible says, bless them that curse you and pray for them that despitefully use you. See, the Bible says you overcome evil with good. And so that's what we must do. We must fight using the Word of God. And we got to give these people Jesus, because there is no other name on earth whereby men must be saved other than Jesus Christ. You know, I heard a story about a man by the name of Darrell Davis. Darrell Davis is a black man. In the last 30 years of his life, he has been going around befriending Ku Klux Klanners. Yeah, a black man going around making friends with Ku Klux Klanners. Somebody asked him one day, how did you come to the point and place in your life that you, a black man, going around the nation making friends with Ku Klux Klanners? He says, it's simple. My mama, dad, and them, they moved to a little suburb town right outside of Boston when I was a little boy. And I joined the Cub Scouts. And as a result, I was the only black in that particular troop. And we had a parade in our little town. And they asked me to carry the flag. This black boy carrying the flag in the middle of the street in a parade. The Cub Scouts, the Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, 4-H Club members, and a whole lot of other folks. They was marching down the street. He says, if we was marching down, he says, as I was carrying that flag, all of a sudden, rocks started hitting me. And then bottles and stuff started hitting me. Then folks start throwing cans at me, hitting me. It was some young white boys was making fun of me. They was throwing. He said, I couldn't understand it. He said, but a lot of my Cub Scout friends and parents, they began to circle me and put a circle or human shield around me to keep me from being hidden. As a result, when I finally made it back home, I told my mama and them, and my mama and them, they began to explain to me that what happened, you was attacked by racist white men. That's what that was about. And he said he couldn't understand how in the world somebody could just hate him because of the color of his skin. He couldn't understand. He said, but mama, daddy, they don't even know me. How can people hate me that don't even know me? And he said that question just haunted him. So he started going and getting books on Ku Klux Klans and trying to understand the Klan. He started getting books on neo-Nazi, trying to understand all these different kind of hate groups. He started getting books, and for the next 20 years, he began to start reading about it. But he says he still couldn't figure it out. How can somebody hate me and they don't even know me? So he told his secretary one day to call up the Grand Wizard of Maryland, the state of Maryland. And he called up the Grand Wizard of the state of Maryland, and he had a meeting with them. He said, now don't tell him that I'm black. And so he met with the man, and you got this black man and you got this white Ku Klux Klaner. And they met, but he still couldn't understand, why can this man, how can he hate me and he don't really know me? And he asked, can we meet again? And they met again. And he asked, can we meet again? And they met again. And then the man invited him to come to the Ku Klux Klan rally. And he started attending the rallies. And then they continued to keep meeting. And they met for 2 years. CNN heard about it, how this black man and this Ku Klux Klaner had became friends. And they interviewed the Ku Klux Klaner, this grand wizard, and they... And he began to tell them that, yes, me and this man, we've been friends for the last 2 years. And he says, he hadn't changed me and I hadn't really changed to him. But it's one thing about it, we respect each other. I respect him and he respect me and we are friends. Now, when CNN conducted that interview, that man hadn't changed. But shortly after that, that man did change. That man took off his Ku Klux Klan robe, stepped down from his position, renounced the Ku Klux Klan, gave this black man his robe. In other words, that Ku Klux Klan man was changed. But the story don't end there, because since that time, that black man has converted 200 other Klansmen. They done took off their robes and done gave it to that black man. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if God can change the heart of a Klansman, God can change anybody's heart. Oh, what can the righteous do? Oh, the righteous can do a whole lot when these foundations are being destroyed. The righteous can keep watching. They can keep on praying. And they can keep on fighting for the Lord. Let's pray. Father, we thank you and we praise you for who you are, the God who hear, and you still answer prayers. Take this message and use it to change hearts and minds, that all of us can be a better people for thee. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. had another great, wonderful worship service. Thank you so kindly for joining us today. But we never like to leave our broadcast without giving you an opportunity to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. So if you would like to receive Christ as your personal Savior, would you be so kind and bow your head with me and pray this short, simple prayer and give me the privilege of leading you to the throne of grace. Repeat after me. Father, I have sinned and come short of your glory. Forgive me of my sins. I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord. I believe with all my heart you have raised him from the dead. Based on the word of God, I now believe that I'm now saved. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right. God bless you. Welcome to the family. Now go tell somebody about that decision that you have just made, because that's the greatest decision that anybody could have made. And then reach out to us right here at the church and let us know that you received Christ today as your personal Savior. And we can provide you with some literature and some things to kind of help you on your Christian journey. Now, my announcer will have some contact information at the end of the broadcast. So reach out to us and contact us. There are several ways you can contact us. All right, that's it for today, family. Thank you so kindly for joining us. Now, listen, as I always say, stay encouraged. Did you hear what I said? I say stay encouraged. Because God loves you, and so do I, and it's nothing you can do about it. God bless you. Have a good day in the Lord. This time we want to prepare our hearts to worship our Lord in Holy Communion time. We ask that those of you who are at home, if you would go and get your grape juice and get your crackers and celebrate the death, the burial, and the resurrection of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus says, as often as you eat of my flesh and drink of my blood, you show that you have faith in me until I come again. So we'll give you an opportunity to get those elements. And first we will have a song by the male chorus. Thank the Lord. Oh, how I love Jesus because he first loved me. Jesus, you may be seated as we prepare our hearts now to worship our Lord in Holy Communion. Jesus, on the last night with his disciple, he took bread and he blessed it. And he says, this bread is my body of the New Testament that is broken for you and for many. He says, as often as you eat of it, you show that you have faith in him until he comes again. Let me consecrate it. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this bread symbolizing the broken body of Jesus. I ask that you will consecrate it and consecrate all of those this morning that is going to participate with us in Holy Communion. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us eat it together. Then after supper, they took a cup. Jesus said that this blood that is shed for you and for many. As often as you drink of it, you also show that you have faith in me until I come again. Hold up your cup as we consecrate these elements of the juice this morning. Heavenly Father, we offer up before you this juice symbolizing the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. We ask that you would consecrate it, and as we partake of it, consecrate our lives In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us drink it together, brethren. Amen. And the scripture says, after they ate and drank, they went out singing. Now, I don't know exactly what song they went out singing, but here at Bible Way, we sing, I Know It Was the Blood. So sing it with us at home. I know it was the blood. And I know it was blood for me. Well, they whipped him all night long. They whipped him all night long. They whipped him all night long for me. Well, one day Jesus died. And I know it was the blood for me. Well, he never said a mumbling word. He never said a mumbling word. He never said a mumbling word for me. Well, one day Jesus died. Them in its side, they pierced them in its side, they pierced them in its side for me. Oh, one day Jesus. Screaming down, the blood came screaming down, the blood came screaming down. Well, one day Jesus died, and I. Died. He hung his head and died. He hung his head and died for me. One day Jesus died. And I know it was the blood for me. Well, I know it was. Blood. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me. Well, one day Jesus died, and I know it was the blood for me. Amen. Well, that concludes our Sunday morning worship service, as well as our communion service. We hope something was said, something was done to help you and encourage you on your Christian journey. And please Tune in next Sunday as we bring another message and another worship service in the Lord. Amen. God bless you. Have a good day.